ex-Marine Dick Murdoch, who's in the greatest physical shape I've seen him in a long time. He looks like, Jim, he might re-enlist in the Marines any day. He laid out Skandar Akbar, and the only ones to come get him was a one-man gang, and off in Seeker. They've cleared the way, and now Paul Orndorff against Tully Blanchard. Blanchard, the top star from the south.
GWH-TV, bringing you classic wrestling action sanctioned by the Georgia Wrestling History Network.
Hi again, everybody. Welcome back for another episode of Georgia Wrestling History TV on the Georgia Wrestling History News Network. I'm Kenny J, here with John Stoney Cannon, and we've got quite the lineup for you tonight, don't we?
Oh, that's right. And I'm Stoney, not to be confused with Stoney Schiavone. Well, Tony Schiavone, I don't know.
That's not a comparison that I would have drawn.
Well, he had much better hair, he had much better clothes, and sometimes he even had better facial hair.
I see. So we've got some good old-fashioned golden oldies tonight.
From the South!
Mm-hmm.
We're talking down marrows, here. We're talking mullets. I mean, we're talking craziness.
Oh, yeah. We've got all kinds of nutty action for you tonight. We've got some action with Bobby Eaton and the Beast. We've got some Russians later on in the show. Paul, who now?
Orndorff.
That's it. Tully Blanchard. And, of course, we've got to start things off with our opening bell match, which is a ladies' match.
Ooh, it's ladies' night, and the feeling's right. Oh, it's late. Oh, we got a match. Oh, sorry. I got a little carried away.
Yeah, so we're starting things off tonight. We've got Toni Rose versus Winona Littleheart.
I wonder if she's an Indian.
Maybe. I guess we'll just have to find out here in just a sec. Let's hop to it.
And her opponent from Arizona, Winona Littleheart. Winona Littleheart, your referee is Ron West.
All right, Winona Littleheart moving out against Toni Rose, and Rose has the advantage and experience over Littleheart. I happen to know their backgrounds, and Toni Rose, realizing the importance of this tournament, is unleashing a very, very heavy attack on Winona Littleheart. Littleheart, very adept, very agile, has been taken completely taken off guard by Toni Rose. And it is Littleheart trying to regain her feet, and Toni Rose ties her up again. And it is Toni Rose, an experienced veteran, taking every advantage now. And Littleheart hurtled outside the ring and going up rather slowly, coming back into the ring. Hurtled back inside, and of course, jarring that spinal column once again. Toni Rose has not ceased in her constant attack on Winona Littleheart. Toni Rose lashing out with a fist to the midsection, and it is... And Winona Littleheart firing back now. Good move by Littleheart. She's beginning to gain some good second effort here. Chop, a tomahawk chop, and that Indian war dancing moves in on her again. Winona Littleheart from the reservations in Arizona. Flying dropkick that missed as Toni Rose moved out of the way. A knee to the side of the head of Winona Littleheart. Toni Rose, arm with Littleheart into the far turnbuckle. Littleheart on the canvas and again, snap there. And she, a neck breaker, and that is something you very rarely see women wrestlers executing. But that was beautifully executed, a neck breaker, and a rousing boo for the winner.
Just like I will get Joyce Grable and then Moolah. The people of Georgia will see a new champion crowned here in 2 weeks.
Woo, coming right out of that ladies' match. That was quite a fun one to watch, wasn't it?
You always got to love ladies' matches. I mean, even the ones back in the day when, you know, they're dressed exactly like Mae Young and the fabulous Moolah. I mean, big difference back then compared to now. I mean, now it's like, you know, I mean, are they wrestlers or are they Victoria's Secret models? I don't know these days. Back then, you know, women...
I don't know, the classic look was a little bit more threatening.
Yes.
Whew. Well, moving right along, we're going into our Made in the South match. And normally my brother would tell you how that is, but he's been sick as a dog. So he's going to be out for a minute. I'll be standing in for him. So, but the Made in the South match, as you've probably come to find out, takes a look back at some of your favorite classic wrestlers from around the Southeast when they were just getting their start before they got big.
Like you.
Yep.
That big.
Exactly.
So, and this week is a pretty good one. We are going to check out Southeastern Championship Wrestling. Now, on one hand, we have a wrestler called The Beast. Not to be confused with the Beast incarnate Brock Lesnar.
Or the Disney Beast.
No. Nope.
That movie just came out. So, I mean, a lot of people probably get confused.
Yep. So, if you're probably sitting there going, wow, some dude named The Beast was made in the South. No. We're talking about his opponent, Bobby Eaton. Eventually be known as Beautiful Bobby Eaton. Beautiful Bobby Eaton of the Midnight Express. And, you know, he was in a few other factions along the way, you know, Georgia Wrestling, World Championship Wrestling, blah, 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 blah. But this is way back in the down. This might even be pre-mullet.
It might be.
Might even be pre-mullet.
Well,
so
we'll have to keep an eye out and see if that mullet's there or not coming up in our Mid in the South match. Cool. What do you say we hop to it again?
Yeah, it's where are you? He's in the Easter spirit.
I mean, it's almost that time. Yeah. So
he's a good egg, though. Next match.
I'm from South America, The Beast. His opponent, weighing 233 pounds from Huntsville, Alabama, Bobby Eaton. Bobby Eaton, The Beast. Both these gentlemen make their first start on Southeastern Wrestling Television. The Beast out of South America, a very aggressive, tough grappler. And Bobby Eaton comes with high credentials. This young gentleman has held several regional titles, and this is my first time to get a look at him, but I've heard from other wrestlers, promoters, that this young gentleman is certainly a fine athlete. Right now, Eaton with that hammerlock on The Beast. Applying the pressure. The Beast in the reversal. He comes up with a hammerlock. Eaton right back at him on his reverse. The elbow by The Beast frees him. Bobby Eaton down. Catches the hammerlock on the return trip. Arm drag. Take down the arm bar and Bobby Eaton in control. Eaton with that armbar now, as you notice, hooking his leg through and refighting the leg of The Beast. Now swinging that particular leg, but applying more pressure to the shoulder and elbow joint. The Beast, air goes to punch Eaton, and Eaton has moved and comes right back up with the armbar. Young man moves well, very, very fast in that ring. Eaton now straddling his man. Putting his weight, applying that pressure on the armbar. A rabbit punch by The Beast, and another. And Eaton hooks him, takes him over with the arm drag, and maintains control. Beast again with a handful of air, pulls Eaton down, tearing at the eyes now. Bobby hit first into that top turnbuckle, flying first in the center ring. And comes up with a reverse chin lock. Beast grabs a handful of hair, dives over, and takes Eaton with him. Using the laces of his boots, he moves down along the outside. And Eaton retaliates with a couple well-placed right hands. Deals his man cross-ring. Sending over the drop kick. And the Beast out on the count of one. Eaton right on top of him, but the Beast, again, going to the eyes. Drapes Bobby across that center strand of rope. Rabbit punches. And the Beast now mounting an offense. The chop staggers Big Bob. And Eaton right back with a double chop of his own. And a looping right hand spins the big man from South America around. Eaton comes up reverse chin lock now. Eaton applying the pressure now. The Beast showing glimpses of good wrestling, good basic wrestling, but elects to cut the corners, use the hair and the eyes to his advantage. Windmills the arm of Bobby Eaton, drags him into that turnbuckle, and moves in to choke his man. Referee Tommy Weathers calling for the break. Eaton has been slowed down now by the Beast. A kick to the midsection by Bobby, and an elbow moves him out of trouble and out of that corner. And as the Beast comes off those ropes, it's Eaton stinging him with that shot to the midsection. The arm bar, and Bobby, showing that experience, continues to go back to that arm. I'm not aware of what Eaton's pain level may be at this point, but it may possibly have to do with the arm because it continually goes back to the arm. But right now, Beast again breaking the eyes with the laces of his wrestling boot. Moving in now, and referee Weathers calling for the break. Beast with a rabbit punch down across the back. A chop staggers Bobby Eaton, drives him into the corner, and Eaton and loops out with a shot, but not enough to stop the big man. Eaton swings again, misses, comes up with a headlock, and they're exchanging punches now. The Beast comes with a tackle. Catches Eaton again. Eaton catches him on the shoulder. Airplane spin by Bobby Eaton. Diving back on top of his man, hooks him. And you've got a winner.
Boy, I tell you, that beautiful Bobby Eaton.
Yeah, he sure kind of made the Beast guy not quite look so beastly.
Yeah, and look more like the squirrel.
Yeah, he was, you know, just...
The mouse.
Yeah.
The small mammal.
Kind of squirming around looking for his nuts and stuff.
But hey, that's how it goes sometimes in wrestling, especially classic wrestling.
Yep.
When the oldies just keep getting more goldy.
Yep.
Well, moving right along, we're jumping into our next segment, our Georgia Championship Wrestling on Georgia Wrestling History TV segment. What do we have coming up in this segment?
Well, you know, we're actually going to hop to it.
Again.
So, hibbity-hibbity, mm-hmm. hop. But for those of you who have followed the show since last year, we like to follow along with Georgia Championship Wrestling by the month. So we are currently in the month of April, as in April 1980.
And we got to cram some April in there for you, because the last two episodes, as you notice, were more on the special side of things. So not as much GCW.
Nope. So
we got to make up for it.
A lot happening during that time period, and a lot of promos, a lot of talking. Not quite so much wrestling, but a lot of talking. I mean, yeah, Austin Idol being accused of being hired by Harley Race of breaking Tommy Rich's leg. Austin Idol's trying to go after Mr. Wrestling 2 for a title, but at the same time, he's sitting there threatening like he deserves a shot at Harley Race's title. You know, you got the Russians are trying to battle Kevin Sullivan and Tony Atlas for some belts. I mean, and in this whole mix, you had all kinds of things like Baron von Raschke, and I mean, it was just craziness. So enjoy this mix of promo material, some of the best talkers in the world talking crapola on each other. And in the middle of all this, Austin Idol battles Mr. Wrestling 2.
Mr. Wrestling 2 is one of my faves.
Yeah, in a championship match.
Yeah. So I'm excited about this one. I hope he comes out on top. Guess we'll just have to find out. Guess we'll just have to hop to it.
Yep.
Injury that it's really hard for Tommy to be able to tell how badly he was hurt. In the past, before some of the newer orthopedic procedures, a knee like his would have to be opened up for surgery and repaired. But now with the new arthroscopic procedures, which is basically putting in a tube into the knee, which you're able to look through the tube, you can put light through the tube, and you can actually do surgery through the tube. The biggest thing about that tube or scope is that the doctor can look around inside of the knee and figure out what is hurt. When he did this to Tommy last Wednesday, we were very lucky to find that he only had one ligament torn and his cartilages were in very good shape. Now, if we can move down here and look at his knee, you'll notice that there are four pinholes here. These are the holes that the arthroscope was put through to get various angles in the knee. Now,
well, there you have it, of course. Since that time, you've totally recouped, but it was just a week later after that report was given. It was a week later that you and I were in this very position, standing here, and we were talking about your leg, the condition it was in, and, of course, that time you were still on crutches, but you were feeling very confident.
Yes, sir. I started going up and down steps. I started out, you know, from the day he let me out, I got on the crutches and walking and everything, and right here you'll see where Idol tries again. You know, he ain't going to give up.
All right, let's take a look at that interview.
Hold this for a second here, and we'll just take a couple of strolls up there. I'm trying hard, giving it my best to get it loose. I'm working on it all the time.
And Tommy Rich moving over there. You see him moving a lot better than he has been, and going up those steps. Certainly, that's very, very encouraging, and that's something that I think all of us take totally for granted, of course, is that capability of walking up and down steps. And I know what Tommy must be going through, but... He's, as you can see, he's getting a lot more flexibility in that knee and in the entire leg. Building up that muscle. Oh, wait just a second.
You know, that's really touching, Rich. That really warms the cockles of my heart. You know what I think, Rich? I think that injury is nothing but a fake. I think that injury is a phony. Do you know that it's a fact that you never held on to a title for more than 5 or 6 days at one time? It's a fact. You ain't nothing but a coward. You don't want to give me a title match. You don't want to give me a return match. That thing is a phony injury. You ain't no hurt, and you ain't nothing but a phony. You come from a whole family of phonies, and that's all I got to say.
Wait just a minute now. Tommy Rich has been lying mired into that ring in a full body slam, and this Rich, I don't know how much injury he suffered here, but Austin Idol is trying to go for that figure four, and if he gets that figure four on, Tommy Rich is bound to be laid up for a long time. And of course, Wrestling 2 broke that one up in a hurry, and thank goodness he did, but it didn't take much of a man to Pearl Harbor you from behind.
Well, that's Austin Idol. That's your whole thing, brother. You pick your spots. Anytime you see your shot to jump in, that's like you got the belt from two. It took three guys to do that. Well, Idol, I want to tell you something. I've had a long, long time to think about it, and I'm not hurting no more. I'm not hurting no more. That knee is completely ready to go, Idol. You know, for 4 weeks, 5 weeks, I've laid up. You said I couldn't defend my belt. Well, I beat Killer Khan. I've defended my title since then. I beat him. So, Idol, I'm going to tell you something, brother. I want to tell you something. I hope you're somewhere listening. You know, just like I said, you can take so much, you can get pushed so far, but then that's it. You got, you know, it comes a time you got to stand up and be a man. Well, it's my time now, Idol. Just like I said, You know, I signed my contract to wrestle Harley Race. Well, you knocked me out of that, Idol. And right now, as far as I'm concerned, the biggest match in the world, or you know, I feel like all these people here, they're all behind me, and the biggest one in the world.
Tomorrow night at the Omni, you've got your chance.
That's exactly right. Austin Idol, tomorrow night, Easter Sunday, I finally got my chance, you know. You talk about big matches. Well, this is the biggest one I've ever had. I'm going to prove myself to be a man. Idol, I'm coming after you. And I want you more than I've ever wanted anything in my life. And at the Omni Sunday night, you better be ready for one heck of a fight, because I ain't coming to wrestle. I'm coming to hurt you like you're hurting me at the Omni. Idol, you better be ready to go, because I'm ready right now, brother.
Austin Idol is here.
I heard Tommy Rich out here whining and moaning and groaning, and it actually made the humble one shed tears from my eyes. And you can look right here. This is the crying towel that actually made tears come out of Austin Idol's eyes because of Tommy Rich's big sob story. Now you're talking about, everybody's talking about the Idol being a bounty hunter and that I'm jumping in on people's matches. Well, let's show the other side of the story. Let's show what Tommy Rich has been doing. You've got the film. Let's see the other side of the story now.
Well, I would assume you're talking about the one time that certainly Tommy Rich did what he had to do. Let's take a look.
I'll tell you exactly what I'm giving this man, the whipping that his father wouldn't give him when he was a baby. I'm going to take a belt to him like you would any other dog, and that's all he is. Now, is that your champion? Wrestling, too, has been running roughshod in the Georgia area for quite some time. But I am the first man in Wrestling, too's wrestling career.
Sir, it looks to me like you're trying to scrap that belt around the leg just the way you injured Tommy Rich and put him out of action.
And look at that. Look at Tommy. Well, everybody's sticking their nose in my business. But look at the man has knocked me completely out. I'm unconscious at this point in time. But look, even still, I did not relinquish that Las Vegas leg lock. I did not. And at that point right there, I will guarantee you, just as sure as my name is Austin Idol, just as sure as I am the prettiest man that ever walked the face of the earth, if that wrestling crew is screaming, please let me go. I quit.
Oh, I find that difficult to believe, sir. First of all, you said you heard him say, I quit. Wrestling, too, has never quit. However,
he said, I quit. I heard him say, I quit.
All right, now, it was just a short time later, in fact, on March 22nd, sir, that you came out here, you made the statement that you had challenged Wrestling 2 to a match. And you said the minute the challenge was made that he suddenly, very frighteningly, left the building. Okay? We found out later what the situation was surrounding the circumstances his leaving the building. Also, suddenly, a person appeared in the ring who appeared to be Wrestling Number 2. And in fact, turned out to be not to be Wrestling Number 2. Now, all of this ties in with the World Heavyweight Championship, the fact that you want the title match, Wrestling 2 wants it. Let's go back to that moment in time.
Let's go. Let me see it, too.
And Austin Idol up on that second rope. Crashing down. And I'm beginning to wonder if that... He doesn't seem to have the same kind of... He's caught in that figure four, but he doesn't seem to have... He's conceding? Well, I can't believe that. I can't believe Wrestling 2 would ever concede. I absolutely cannot believe that Wrestling 2 would ever concede. Austin Idol, I'm just beginning to have some doubts here about this entire situation. He didn't seem to have the...
You saw it all right there. Everybody saw what happened there. And they didn't just see it in Georgia. They saw it in Alexandria, Louisiana. They saw it in New Orleans. They saw it in Chicago. They saw it in Knoxville. They saw it in New York. I made the so-called legend give up. I made the so-called legend quit. He screamed. I heard him scream. I quit. I give. You are the best. You are the master. There's Wrestling 2. Look at him.
That's the thing that has
licking his wounds.
I can't.
Show your puzzles. He is licking his wounds, and now that he is out of the way, there's only one more to fall, and that will be none other than Harley Race. Harley Race will fall now. I will have the Georgia title now. The Georgia title belongs to me, right in the middle of the ring. That buffoon, I made him give up. The most devastating hole of all.
Watch out! Whoa! Wait a minute! And that is wrestling. There's no question in my mind now that that is wrestling too, in his street clothes. Wrestling too. We've got to get... He has charged him right here on the interview set. Wrestling too, in an absolute fury. And so that means one thing for sure, that that man in the ring was not in fact wrestling too. All right, let's set the record straight.
You look at that animal. You saw what that animal did to me, and he was fined $2,500, and he should have been suspended. Like I said before, he is an escaped convict, and he should be out of wrestling.
Well, first of all, the only reason Wrestling 2 left the building that morning is because he received an emergency phone call saying a relative was in the emergency room at the hospital. That turned out to be a fraudulent call. No such thing happened at all. That's why Wrestling 2 left the building. When he came back and saw a phony Wrestling 2 in the ring, he did the only thing he could do, sir. However, then the following week, the Georgia Heavyweight Championship on the line, and it took three, didn't it, Mr. Idol?
Took three? What are you talking about? It took three.
All right, let's take a look at that Georgia Heavyweight Championship match here on television.
My own man.
World Heavyweight Champion Harley Race out there, issuing some comments to Austin Idol. Wrestling two with a side headlock. Austin Idol brings him up. Brings him down on that knee. And Harley Race applauding the efforts of Austin Idol. A very prejudicial situation. Austin Idol tried to set him with a Las Vegas leg lock, but Wrestling 2 broke him up. Wrestling 2 catches him, explodes with the right hand. Wrestling 2 brings him up a full body slam. High knee lift, has Idol on the canvas into a lateral press. Meltzer. His foot is up, and Wrestling 2 and Harley Race. Harley Race caught by Wrestling 2. And it is now Wrestling 2 catching, the referee hurtled into the ropes. Wrestling 2 has been dazed on this one. Austin Idol catches him with a hard right hand. And it is Wrestling 2 caught again. The referee is still down, and Harley Race doing something with that Georgia Heavyweight Championship belt. Race wrapping that belt around the turnbuckle. Austin Idol and Wrestling 2 battling it out. The Georgia Heavyweight Championship on the line. The referee is still down and out. Austin Idol catches him again. And it is Race, as you can see, still working with that heavyweight. And it was Austin Idol hurtled into the belt. Austin Idol smashed into that belt on the turnbuckle, the Georgia Heavyweight Championship belt. Tommy Rich, some of the charges on the scene. Tommy Rich after the World Heavyweight Champion Harley Race. We've got a battle going on in the ring and outside the ring. Harley Race is down. Tommy Rich still after him. Rich in his street clothes. And it is Wrestling 2 getting Austin Idol with a full Boston Crab. Just a moment. There comes Baron Von Raschke. Von Raschke smashing Wrestling 2 back into that belt. Now put the claw on him. It's broken up. Tommy Rich in there. And it is Austin Idol. Wait, up. No. Austin Idol caught Wrestling 2 in a dazed condition, crawl over him, and we have...
Well, sir, you won the title. There's no question about that.
You better believe I won the title. The man of which I won it has nothing to do with it. Harley Race stuck his nose in there, I think, for one reason. to make sure that that match was going to be on the up and up and that it was going to be fair and square. It was a no disqualification match. The end result is I won the match, and I should be wrestling Harley Race for the world's title. I should be the number one contender for the world's title, and I am the number one contender for the world's title. And wrestling too, if you think that you are, then you're crazy.
Well, he has the match, but tomorrow night at the Omni, Tommy Rich has you, sir.
Listen, this is going to be like school. I'm going to be the teacher, and Tommy Rich, you're going to be the student. I gave you one lesson, and I thought one lesson would be enough, but you didn't get the drift. Now I'm going to give the final and the ultimate lesson, and you better believe one thing, darling, in the Omni tomorrow night, school will be out, and I am the ruler, I am the teacher, and Rich, you will pay for everything. Well, Sully, you know, I think one point should be made very clear. You're probably wondering about the display of nationalism. Well, it seems that there's been a great many displays of nationalism recently, and I think that it's time that we're allowed at least to, or rather should I say, the Russians are allowed to express their sense of national pride.
Well, in the true American spirit, that is permissible, yes, sir.
Another point I'd like to make is that with a finely honed, well-conditioned, extremely knowledgeable, brilliant team like the Russians, we haven't got to worry about any opponent, pair of opponents, threes, fours, any combination of opponents you'd like to throw at this great team from Russia. Well, we welcome the challenge. We've had a great many, I would say, very difficult tests. But we have another test coming up very shortly.
Tomorrow night, as a matter of fact.
As a matter of fact, in the Omni. Now, this is probably, in the eyes of a great many people, our greatest test yet. The team of Tony Atlas and Kevin Sullivan in the Omni. Well, I'll tell you this right now, Tony Atlas and Kevin Sullivan, you've never faced anything like the team of the great Iron Russians. And I, Rock Hunter, guarantee that either Kevin Sullivan or Tony Atlas will submit with our hammerlock.
We'll find out tomorrow night at the Omni. Kevin Sullivan, a dynamite tag team combination.
Well, thank you, Gordon. You know, I was out here a little while ago, and I was listening to the Russians. And I listened to Rock Hunter, and he let something slip. He says, we're going to show some nationalism. I thought the man was an American. And if you're an American, you're supposed to be proud of this country. The man is nothing but a lowlife. And I heard them say they're going to put a hammerlock on me and Tony and make us submit. Well, I'm going to tell you one thing. You could break our arms off, and we're not going to give up to any Russians.
Well, you know, I listen to him out here talk about putting hammerlocks and everything on people and going to break people up. Well, you let me tell you something, Rock Hunter. You looking at two men right now that have worked hard to get to where they are now. You looking at two men that if you just rip my arms out of the socket, I still ain't going to give up. And if you think you could break these two arms, they're two pretty good arms here, brother. If you think you could do anything with either one of them, you just bring them two big old German egg-headed scanners on, because we got something for them.
Well, tomorrow night at the Omni, of course, the Georgia Tag Team Championship on the line.
You know, Gordon, I never promised anything that I couldn't accomplish. And I have a man here, and I've promised the people before, and I've promised the people at home. Right now, I'm going on my word that if Tony and I don't win, we're leaving. There's nothing to be afraid of, because if we didn't win, I couldn't show my face. And I guarantee the people, next week on TV, Tony Atlas and myself are going to be the new champion.
Oh, man, you know, I was hoping that Wrestling 2 would come out with the win. But no. Yeah, Fast One pulled on him.
Yeah.
That's all right. We can't always get what we want.
Well, you know, Austin Idol can at least say that he did much better in wrestling than he did in politics. So,
but I mean, most people, so have others.
Yep. I mean, not everybody can be Jesse Ventura.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, as you saw during this, the Russians have kind of goaded Kevin Sullivan and Tony Atlas into a match, and maybe we'll see that next episode.
Man, we've got Russians, we've got politicians,
bodybuilders,
future cult leaders. We're getting into some dark places here, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
I mean, and that doesn't even count, like, your usual, like, bunch of, like, country bumpkins, rednecks, farmers, Germans. I mean, you want to say America is the melting pot? GCW was, like, the melting pot of wrestling. You had everything there.
Oh, yeah.
Except
for... from all walks of life, all corners of the planet.
That's right. Everything except for the maybe the wrestling squid. That's about it.
Yeah, which I don't know if that would have flown. So, too many legs.
Yep.
But, yeah, that's just how it is. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing how the April month of GCW wraps up next week. But before then, we've got to jump into the last segment of the night, our main event. It's going to be a good one.
It's going to be really, really good. You have two future Hall of Famers.
Definitely.
Pretty much, you know, I mean, two of the all-time greats. And you could almost call this a Made in the South match because you have two wrestlers wrestling in Mid-South before they made their ultimate names.
Made in the South 2.
Made in the South 2.
Lost in New York.
Yep. So, you know, on one hand, you have future Hulk Hogan rival Paul Orndorff.
Yeah. You gotta be a good man to be his rival.
That's right. Taking on, and this is a rarity, check this out, in Mid-South, and I believe this is a championship title match too, taking on mostly known for his stint in the Four Horsemen, Tully Blanchard. This is before Baby Doll.
Yeah.
Well before Baby Doll.
I'm excited. So, this will be a good one.
It'll be a great match.
We got Hulk's rival, pre-Baby Doll. We got this.
Yep.
We're going to jump into the next one. We've done enough hopping today.
Yep.
So let's jump on in to the main event. Let's go.
Sweet.
The event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 232 pounds from San Antonio, Texas, Tully Blanchard. And in the blue corner at 243 pounds from Tampa, Florida, former North American heavyweight champion Paul Orndorff.
This match getting underway. Your fan at home was unable to see what happened. It's quite a few minutes span between the last match and this one because Skander Akbar laid out cold by ex-Marine Dick Murdoch, who's in the greatest physical shape I've seen him in a long time. He looks like, Jim, he might re-enlist in the Marines any day. He laid out Skander Akbar, and the only ones come get him was a one-man gang, and offense seeker. They've cleared the way, and now Paul Orndorff against Tully Blanchard. Blanchard, the top star from the Southwest.
Great move by Paul Orndorff. Orndorff's got to be one of the most explosive athletes, probably the finest conditioned athlete I've seen in quite some time in the squared circle. Paul Orndorff, former North American champion, he wants that title back in the worst way that I've seen any athlete want to try to accomplish a goal. Paul Orndorff has got his sights set on winning that North American championship. Of course, boy, he's got his work cut out for him here. Tully Blanchard, a great athlete in his own right. Tully Blanchard, former All-Missouri Valley Conference quarterback at West Texas State, an outstanding Texas high school football player, now making quite a name for himself here in professional wrestling. But if he's going to make a name for himself, he's going to have to do it on somebody besides Paul Orndorff, because Orndorff is probably one of the toughest guys around the country right now. And Orndorff has got his sights, as I said, on one thing. That's that North American championship. And whatever it takes to get back to Bob Roop, I think that's what he'll do.
If I've ever seen one man with a mission, if I've ever seen one man, Jim, with an obsession for any one thing, it's Paul Orndorff wanting that North American heavyweight title. He's been defiled. He's been blocked on many occasions. A lot of times things unbeknownst has been plotted up against him, but he wants it so bad that he'll do anything and he'll never give up in quest for that title.
That's exactly right, Boyd. Now, I don't want to detract from this match, but with General Skander Akbar unconscious, I'm looking down the card here. Later on today, it's going to be Ernie Ladd and the Assassin against Afa and Sika, the Samoans. General Skander Akbar, Boyd, I don't say he can be at ringside. If he's not at ringside, it's going to be 2-on-2. I'm going to put my money on Ernie Ladd and the Assassin. I think that Samoans are going to get something that they've had coming to them for quite some time.
Skander Akbar, the direct cause of the injuries here in the Mid-South area. But whatever you reap, Therefore shall you sow, Akbar. And it looked like, after what happened to him a minute ago, that Dick Murdoch is back after his injury. Ernie Ladd is back. He'll be in the match later on. Ted DiBiase, injured, will be back in 2 weeks. So they're all men. They're all strong men. They're not just forgetting it. They're coming back to the place where it happened, Jim. So
General,
Akbar is going to really get it from all sides. He dished it out. He'll have to take it.
That's exactly right. You have to pay the consequences. And, of course, back to the match at hand right here. Paul Orndorff has got Tully Blanchard in a pinning predicament. However, Blanchard into the ropes. The referee must break the hold. And Blanchard did not break cleanly. Seized the opportunity to gain the advantage on Orndorff. And comes down with a thunderous elbow right to the back. And now Blanchard, he's a very aggressive man. Tully Blanchard has got quite a reputation of his own to uphold, and he is a tough, tough man going for that standing suplex. Orndorff blocked it. Orndorff blocked the suplex and applied it to Tully Blanchard, and now Blanchard's on the defensive.
Power knee by Paul Orndorff.
Of course, the issue between Bob Root and Paul Orndorff building to a fever pitch. Orndorff wants that title. Bob Roop has it. Now Orndorff trying to go for it. And he's going for it. He's going to try to set Blanchard for that Boston Crab, a submission hold, one of the first submission holds ever used in wrestling, the Boston Crab. Orndorff's got it set. And Blanchard powers out. Orndorff's head has hit the mat. Now Blanchard now becoming the aggressor once again. Blanchard going for the figure four. Blanchard. It looks like deja vu going for that figure four now. And Blanchard has really got it locked in. Blanchard has really got that figure four locked in. But remember, Orndorff knows the reversal. Orndorff, along with Bob Root, devised the reversal. And now the hole is reversed. The hole has been reversed. And now Orndorff has got the hole on Blanchard.
Well, the fans screaming, and that's what it's all about. There you see, Bob Root. On the top rope coming down.
Bob Root coming off that top rope.
Heck, Al called for the bell, Jim.
We're going to have a disqualification in this match. Root is putting the boots to Paul Orndorff, and out goes Orndorff. And there you see Bob Root coming from nowhere. Paul Orndorff had the figure four reversed and had the match in hand.
There you have it, the disqualification off of the top rope. We'll be back. More action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling and the hand being raised of Paul Orndorff by Jack Howe.
Well, if you didn't see that one, I would suggest you rewind and watch it again.
Be kind, rewind, be kind, rewind, be kind, rewind.
See, we haven't heard that phrase. Well, nobody has to rewind. Tapes. Do people sell those? I have some.
Yep.
But do people sell them? Besides Goodwill?
I don't know. Oh. You know, that could almost be considered not only a Made in the South match, that could be considered a North versus South match. I mean, Tully Blanchard...
It's a Civil War match.
Tully Blanchard had his moments up North, but was mainly known as a Southern wrestler. And while Paul Orndorff had his moments in the South, he was mainly known as a Northern wrestler. And by Northern wrestler, I mean those guys up there. You know, the only guys really left out there.
So that's pretty cool. We had a bit of a Mid-South Wrestling Civil War.
Pretty much.
That's cool. That's cool. Well, it's been a fun show. We've just been kind of hanging out, doing our own thing. It's been a good one. So, we will leave you guys with something that you haven't seen in a while. We'll just have to let you find out what that is.
Gas?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure, why not?
Cool.
All right, well... It's been a good one. I'm Kenny J. This is John Stoney Cannon. And we will see you next time on Georgia Wrestling History TV. Adios.
Terry.
And where are you from, Terry?
Decatur.
Decatur, okay. And you, young man?
Skip.
Okay, Skip, where are you from?
Thornton.
Where?
Norcross.
Oh, okay, fine. I'll accept that as an answer. You know, there's no problem there. A fine group of youngsters. And, Kevin, it is inspiring to see these youngsters feel so strongly as they do about the USA.
Well, goodness, what Toni and I have talked about. We have people that support us, and this is the backbone of our country. And I've, you know, growing up, people have always talked about the young children of today. I couldn't think of a better group of people right here, Georgia and all around the United States, and they support us. And what's the word? Good. This is why those Russians don't have a chance against us. Well, they belong to us.
Well, of course, he's referring to the Georgia Tag Team Champions, and may I just say, too, that I, too, am very heartened to see these youngsters with this great fervor. As I said earlier, this great wave of patriotism sweeping the United States. Certainly, this is something that all of us need to take into consideration during these extremely troubled times. Our time is completely gone for this hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling from Atlanta, Georgia, USA. So long.